Welcome. We're excited to hear about rethinking energy and how to get affordable and adequate electricity in Minnesota. Bill?
Thanks, Kim. And I wanted, before I get going here, I wanted to thank pretty much everyone in the room here. So first, thanks to the chamber for hosting this event and allowing us to take over your little meeting here for this interval. I wanted to introduce, you know, my name is on the document, but this is by no means my own effort. I wanted to acknowledge the people in the room who contributed to it. Peter Nelson sitting over there in the corner, huge help, not just in preparing this document, but in the few years leading up to this document, doing great work on energy policy in addition to all of his work on healthcare and all the other issues he covers for the center. And I'm missing where he went in the room. John Seymour was here. John, where did you go? Oh, way back in the corner. There he is. John was a big help in putting this together. And immediately behind him, Tom Kelly, who's the chair of the of the center, big help as well. And Kim herself, and putting the finishing touches on the work and her own work in the energy sector over the last few years. So this is a team effort, and it's not just me and my thoughts, but a group of us who have gotten together over the last few weeks and months to put our thoughts on what we can do on energy policy in the state of Minnesota going forward. I also want to recognize Scott Honor, a candidate for governor, who will be on the ballot on Tuesday. Good to see candidates interested, not just in winning votes, but getting good ideas, and hopefully we'll get some good ideas this morning. again, Kim mentioned this is the fourth chapter, or the fourth preliminary chapter that we've rolled out from the center, and a little unique in the energy chapter. We've had, am I right, Kim, pensions was one. We had transportation and education. And now we have energy. And the thing about the first items, transportation, education, and pensions, at least the existence of the problem is well known and understood and widely acknowledged. And for example, in the field of education, everybody understands what our goals are, or for the most part, what our goals are in educating our young people. And everyone who's involved in the public discussion of that, public policy discussion of that, acknowledges the achievement gap, how large it is, who it impacts, and what fixing it would mean to the advancement of our many goals in the state. And when I talk about energy, I'm going to focus almost exclusively on electricity, because we think that's the part of energy policy in Minnesota that needs the most immediate attention. And I was going to say that everyone in the room is hearing all this stuff for the first time, but seeing representatives from some of our utilities and our investment community and our public policy community. So many of you will have heard this stuff before. So I apologize for repeating stuff you already know. But for those of you who don't follow electricity policy and haven't been involved in the evolution of our state's energy policy over the last 20 years, might not be familiar with the story of how we got here from where we started. And how, well, we have many successes to tout in areas like wind power and solar power and energy efficiency. Those have all come at a price to consumers, that has in a lot of ways harmed the state's competitiveness in world markets and national markets, trying to compete in some of our energy intensive industries. And electricity is one of those ubiquitous things, why we have lights today, why the coffee is warm, and everything else that we get from electricity, we take for granted, at least for the last 100 years or so. But it's not just the cost that higher electricity prices impose on our big industry, but everything else we buy, whether it's groceries in the grocery store, or whether it's a round of golf on this wonderful golf course outside of our windows here, it's impacted by the cost, at least in a small way, by the cost we pay for energy, and specifically electricity. So as we launch into what I'm going to talk about this morning, a little bit of an overview. I will mention that Peter did all the animation in today's PDF, so you know, have any concerns about that? He's right in the back of the room. we try to structure our paper in some of the ways that the other chapters are structured. Identify the problem, point out some solutions, and give you a sense of what will happen if we don't address this issue. But the first bullet, I was going to say, this will come as a surprise to everybody in the room, but it won't, because of some of you who have been involved in this industry for decades, that our prices are high and rising. And this is true of everything, you know, whether you're buying a pound of ground beef or whether you're buying a gallon of gasoline, you've noticed that prices have gone up. But we, in our work, have looked at how electricity prices in Minnesota have gone up compared to inflation. They have risen at rates faster than the general inflation rates. How they compare to other states. And prices in Minnesota have been increasing at rates faster than the national average, and faster than not just other states in the country, but other states in our region. So, but you will hear just the opposite from a lot of the advocates of renewable energy and green energy policies, that not only are prices not going up because we've invested in wind power, prices have actually gone down. But we looked really hard at the data, and this isn't stuff we put together. We've looked at primary sources, the U.S. Department of Energy, and other people who are paid to get these numbers right, and not only are our prices high, but they're going up at a faster rate than almost anywhere else in the country. So, and that's a real concern for our state's competitiveness. And the proximate cause of this, what are we doing that other states aren't doing, or what are we doing more of than other states are doing? And it's these green energy policies. And I do want to take just a moment at the outset to make a little bit of a contrast between what I'm calling green energy policies and environmental protection policies. That Minnesota and the United States has done a tremendous job dating back decades. You know, whether you want to, maybe back to the year that the Cuyahoga River caught on fire in Cleveland and burned for days, to the founding of the Environmental Protection Agency, to the first Earth Day, that the environmental story in Minnesota and nationwide has seen, the environment has seen tremendous improvement, whether it's sulfur dioxide. When was the last time you heard about acid rain? Nitrous oxides, it's one of the precursors of smog, or ozone, or any of the mercury, any of the other pollutants that are clearly identified and clearly cause harm. We've done a tremendous job in outright reducing the impact of pollution on our society. And it's been a tremendous success story. I don't think we often give enough credit to all the work that's been done over the decades. But the green energy policies, and I'm going to discuss this in a little bit more detail, are not environmental protection policies. They are, have different goals in mind, and there are different benefits that they tout and things they're trying to accomplish. And I want to make a contrast. Nothing that we're discussing here is going to have an impact on the environment, even if all of our recommendations are implemented. We think there's pretty clear evidence that high energy prices, particularly high electricity prices, result in the elimination of jobs in Minnesota. And I'll focus on jobs in the manufacturing sector because it's one of the hardest hit that is the most sensitive to the price of electricity. And again, I use this example. When I pay my electric bill, if it's 10% more than it was last month, I probably won't notice. If I do notice, I'll attribute it to, well, it was cold last month, or it was warm last month, it must be something to do with the weather. And, you know, I'm lucky enough in my place in life that I don't think twice about writing a check to pay the electric bill. But for a lot of Minnesota households, it's one of the biggest expenses they have. And for many Minnesota households, households across the country, it ranks only behind shelter, food, and transportation. It's usually the number four expense that a household has. And so when we're talking about rising rates for electric service, the people who are hardest hit are those at the bottom of the income scale. And that is something that's not widely understood, widely acknowledged, and has a big impact on all of our other efforts, whether it's fighting income inequality or whether it's trying to build up a ladder to prosperity. The cost that people pay to keep the lights on is a significant cost if you're at the bottom end of the income scale. And we've heard, and I'm sure you could pick up a newspaper or listen to the radio and hear all sorts of benefits touted from our green energy policies. In fact, President Obama has done events here in Minnesota and elsewhere where he has singled out Minnesota as the example of how energy policy is done and done right, and using us as an example for the other 49 states to follow, which is pretty scary when you look at the cost numbers involved in paying for all of these green energy policies. There's a big cost to being a nation leader in some of these areas. So if you could so again, because some of the people in the room or watching this video or reading our report are probably hearing this for the first time, energy prices in Minnesota are high, and they are rising, and they are rising rapidly. If you go back 20 years, Minnesota, and this is a little counterintuitive with the way we present this, if you go back 20 years ago, Minnesota had some of the lowest energy prices in America. We ranked as the 19th lowest electricity price provider, Minnesota did, back in the year 1995, which was good. Be a great top 20 list to be in, one of the top 20 most affordable states for electricity in America, which only stands to reason if you understand the geography of energy supply. The middle of the continent is where you want to be if you want to pay low prices. We don't have any coal or natural gas here in the state, but we are very close to states that have lots of coal, states that produce lots of natural gas. We have some large and well-functioning nuclear power plants. We have pipelines that crisscross our state from every direction, bringing energy from other states. We have high-voltage transmission lines bringing cheap coal power from the west, cheap hydropower from Canada. If you wanted to place a state in the North American continent to be the best position you could be for affordable energy, you couldn't do much better than where Minnesota is located. It's a happenstance of geography. It has to do with where energy supplies like coal and natural gas are located. We don't use much oil in electricity production, so that's not a big help there. But we're very close to hydropower, coal, and natural gas resources from elsewhere in this continent. And we're able to locate facilities like nuclear power plants. We don't sit on a coastline or some of the other issues involved in siting these locations. So you would think, and all of the neighboring states around us except for Wisconsin, also share the happenstance of having very low energy prices. So you would expect to see low energy prices in the mid-continent. We had them 20 years ago. We had the 19th lowest or most affordable price for residential retail electricity. And you can see we're the blue line. We're steadily going up. Now we're back up to, we're 34th most affordable. That is, most states have more affordable electricity for their residential customers than Minnesota does. The red line is the average price per kilowatt hour, which is over 10 cents per kilowatt hour. And you have the West and North Central, the Department of Energy divides up the country into regions, and they have paired us with other states in this West-North Central region that includes all of our neighbors except Wisconsin, for whatever reason, as well as Kansas and Missouri are in our region. So you looked at, we were below average for our, not just the nation, but for our region back in 1995. You can see we were above average for our region. Most states have cheaper electricity than we do, What's probably most disturbing about the series of graphs is the slope, for those of you who are into statistics and mathematics. This is not a sustainable slope. When you see not just they're rising, but how steeply prices in this state are rising relative to the rest of the country. And again, this is not adjusted for inflation. So you would expect to see these numbers drift up over time, but not at that rate of climb. So this is a commercial electricity, and this for Chamber of Commerce members is probably the number that impacts you the most. So if you're a retail store or you're running office space or some function like that, we don't fare as badly in that measure. But the next range is the one that should be most concerning to people who are involved not just in energy policy but economic development. This is the industrial energy prices. So I said, I wouldn't notice a 10% increase in energy prices, electricity prices, on my utility bill. These are the folks who a 10% increase makes or breaks their business. So if you're an oil refinery or a paper mill or a steel mill, you're in the iron mining industry, you are an energy-intensive industry. So industries like those, maybe after raw inputs, your raw materials, this is the number one expense, more than labor, sometimes more than capital. Sometimes this is the number one expense. There are facilities that, the nature of the business, they convert electricity into other products. And if you have electricity as one of your top one, two, or three cost items, you are very sensitive to the price of electricity. And some of our industry in Minnesota competes not just with Iowa and our neighboring states, they compete with the rest of the country, the rest of the world. And so when they're looking to locate a facility or they're looking to expand a facility, this is one of the big factors. And if you're a small Midwestern state and you have high taxes, you have a not so friendly regulatory environment, I have to say the third strike is energy prices. You maybe could survive two of those three, but if you're trying to compete and you have high energy prices on top of an unfavorable tax and an unfavorable regulatory environment, you're probably not going to attract a lot of energy intensive industry. Whether we're talking oil refineries or a lot of these other industries, these are high paying jobs for blue collar workers, often union jobs, and they are the backbone of a lot of communities in our state. And we've had the benefit of low energy prices historically, and Minnesota has become the home to a lot of energy intensive industries, whether it's up north in the Iron Range, whether it's around the metro area with our oil refineries, elsewhere in the state with our wood, timber, and paper industry. We have grown this state. Some of the biggest names in the history of the, going back to the 1800s, some of the biggest names in the history of our state got their start in these industries. And they're the legacy industries that still employ thousands and thousands of people in the state that communities depend on for their very survival. And when you go to the point, you can't quite see at the beginning, back in 1995, not only were we very competitive nationwide in our energy electricity prices, but we were below average in our region. Hard to believe now. And not only are we not below average in our region, not only are we one of the more expensive states for electricity for industrial customers, we have somehow managed to get above the national average. You think the national average is comprised of places like Hawaii and California, who from an energy perspective, you don't ever want to be associated with, and they really drive the average up. But again, the most disturbing thing about this graph is if you're a large energy-intensive industry in the state of Minnesota, and you see this as your as the trajectory of prices here, it's really tough to make the case to your corporate owners, whether they're back in Brazil or whether they're in Sweden or wherever they might be, that Minnesota is a place that that company should be putting their capital. So you know, we can complain about how high our electric bill is when you're buying electricity for your small business or whether you're paying your bill for your home, but industry goes right to the heart of how competitive we are as an economy with the rest of America, with the rest of our region, with the rest of the world. And high electricity prices is something that we cannot tolerate on top of all the other headwinds that we put in the way of our large businesses in the state. So that's a little outline of what the problem is. And if you look at the data, this is all data we took from the U.S. Department of Energy. This is the federal agency, a cabinet official under Barack Obama. It doesn't tell a good story about where electricity prices have been headed in Minnesota. And again, you know, I was involved in energy policy for the state government for 2.5 years, so I bear my share of the blame for this. But that doesn't mean we have to let it continue in this trajectory for the next 20 years. So a little bit of the outline of what the problem is. And again, you know, trying to think long and hard about where have we gone wrong, or where has our path diverged from the rest of the country? And it really traces back the proximate cause, the direct cause of this is some of the energy policies, the green energy policies that we've put in place for the last 20, sometimes going back 25, 30 years. Peter and I did a fairly close analysis of trying to put the key milestones of when we made big changes to our state's energy policy and the data on prices we pay per kilowatt hour. And we thought we found a pretty strong relationship for, we made a big change in energy policy and you see the effect on prices 2, 3, 4, 5 years down the road. It doesn't happen immediately. As our utility folks know, that it's like an oil tanker on the open ocean. you can turn the wheel and, you know, go get a cup of coffee because nothing's going to happen for a while. It's a capital intensive industry. We have investments that last for decades, generations in fact, and you make a change in policy, it takes a while to filter through the system. So I want to call out a couple of examples of this. Our energy efficiency policy, and this is something that I, as a state energy official, was directly in charge of for 2.5 years. So again, so I bear some of the blame, but I also hope you take some of my comments with a little less than a grain of salt, because on the front lines of that, our energy efficiency mandates date back about 30 years, where we started telling our utilities as a state that you need to start investing in energy efficiency. The way you invest in power plants and transmission lines, we need you to invest in programs that help your customers save energy. And it's mom and apple pie. Who is opposed to using less energy? Every time I screw in one of those twisty light bulbs in my house, I'm thinking of how much money I'm going to save. And contradicting a little bit my earlier statement, you know, I think a few pennies might come off my next bill. Or when I'm shopping for a new appliance, which I do, I look for the Energy Star rating and knowing that, you know, that'll pay off. If I'm going to keep that refrigerator for 20 years, I'll save money in the long run. So energy efficiency is something that, whether it's a bipartisan, multi-partisan, doesn't matter whether you're left or you're right, everybody can agree on that. But what we've done with energy efficiency is we've turned it into a smart program that saves a lot of people energy, into a program we spend a lot of resources on, but I'm not sure we're getting any kind of return that we think we're getting on it. So again, we started about 30 years ago telling our utilities, you need to invest in energy efficiency, just the way you invest in these supply side resources. And then it evolved into a mandate where we said, you need to spend a certain percentage of your revenues on energy efficiency programs. And it was a pretty small number. I remember the 0.5% was true at one point in time. And then it went up to 1%, and now it was 1.5%. And we kept ratcheting up the share of the utility revenues that a utility had to spend on conservation programs. And 1.5%, you know, why are we even talking about this? Well, we got this idea a couple of years ago that instead of just focusing on the inputs, that's just throwing money at the problem, let's focus on results. And so we changed the mandate from a spending mandate to an energy savings mandate. So we told all of our state's utilities, you need to spend money, but you need to show results. You need to show energy savings equivalent to 1.5% of your total energy sales. Well, a little easier said than done. As it turns out, to get 1.5% of energy savings, that is reduced kilowatt hour sales, you have to spend at least on a percentage of a residential customer's bill, something like 5% of the bill to get 1.5% savings. So it's something along the lines of you end up having to spend $5 to save $1.50. And you know, if you're running a business, as I did in my former life, and you're looking at payback as your measure of investment efficiency, you know, to spend $5 to save $1.50, you're maybe at the edge of what you would do as a business if you were doing a capital project, trying to save energy or save something in your cost stream. And you gotta remember, that's the average. So you have programs that are rolled into that number that save a ton of energy. Maybe they pay it for themselves almost immediately. And rolled into that number are projects that have a 5-year payback, 10-year payback, or maybe they never pay back. And so we've mandated results, but given no thought to the cost of achieving those results. And as a result, something that should be on everybody's agenda, yes, more energy efficiency, use less energy, everyone can agree to that, has become a program that's probably gone beyond the level of sustainability. That is, we can't continue spending money at this level to achieve ever-diminishing results. So something I wanted to call a little bit of attention to. Some of the investor-owned utilities in the state, when they file rate cases, have cited, at least in part, the energy mandates. I've studied energy billing practices around the state, part of my consulting work. Some utilities put line items on the bill, renewable energy fee or renewable energy surcharge, where it's not just is it a cost, but it's a line item cost on the bill, trying to pay for these programs that they wouldn't otherwise engage in. some of our cooperatives. We had an effort a couple years ago to put a dollar amount on some of these costs. And we asked our state's utilities to estimate how much this was costing the utility in terms of money. And some of our cooperatively owned, these are member-owned co-ops, have reported back that and this was the renewable energy standard, think of it as the wind power mandate, were costing their members tens of millions of dollars over and above the price they were otherwise paying for electricity. So these are real dollar impacts on local communities, on individual consumers. An interesting case, Xcel is one of our state's utilities, our biggest utility, and they operate in 5 states around the upper Midwest. In fact, all of our state's biggest utilities operate in more than one state. And again, the dirty little secret of some of these energy policies, we've been exporting the cost of these policies to neighboring states. So a utility has a very difficult time running their system just for Minnesota. And in the absence of being able to neatly divide up their system along state lines, the transmission lines run right over the river, that they do one size fits all, and they do one energy procurement for all of their customers in all the states, and they pass the cost of whatever mandate they get into this state onto all their customers and don't try to divide up. Well, North Dakota finally just said no, that they were not interested in paying for Minnesota's green power mandates. And they ended up in a settlement with Northern States Power, and I don't remember the exact dollar figure, it was several million dollars that Xcel agreed not to charge its North Dakota customers based on the fact that those costs represented policy mandates passed by the Minnesota State Legislature, and they were not going to impose those costs on North Dakota consumers. And so if South Dakota gets the same idea, Michigan, Wisconsin, Iowa, some of these other states that Minnesota utilities operate in, that we've gotten a little benefit from the fact that our utilities are all multi-state, and they have been passing some of the cost of these programs on to their customers elsewhere, and we might have to, at the end of the day, bear the full brunt of what we tell the utilities to do. And again, here's something that probably hasn't gotten much publicity, and Peter has done some work. The state of Kentucky, and I'm not sure how to make the equivalent, but it's probably something close to the equivalent of our deed, our Department of Economic Development, did a study a couple of years ago of what the increase in the cost of electricity meant in terms of job losses. And they calculated a set of numbers by industry, and there's several dozen industries represented, that what would happen if you increase the cost of electricity by a penny a kilowatt hour, what impact that would have on employment. And so we took the factors developed by the state of Kentucky in their study, and Peter applied them to Minnesota and found out that just in manufacturing alone, and then granted, as my discussion before, manufacturing is one of the more sensitive industries to electricity costs, that if you increase the cost of electric power by a penny a kilowatt hour, it would have the result on net of losing over 15,000 jobs in the manufacturing sector. And again, that's not trying to count this factory packed up and left because electricity prices got too high. We're doing a macro study over the whole economy. As it happens, if you adjust for inflation, the increase in energy prices in Minnesota over the last 20 years, it works out to a 2 cent a kilowatt hour increase. So, you know, if Kentucky has done their math right, and we've done the math right of applying it to Minnesota, the increase in electricity prices in the last 20 years above the cost of inflation has resulted in about 30,000 jobs lost in the manufacturing sector, which is a tremendous number. It's about 1% of the entire state's employment, the equivalent of that. And when our unemployment rate's still running above where it was a couple of years ago, we still have more than 100,000 people out of work, this ends up being a big number. In fact, just a penny kilowatt hours worth of loss in manufacturing jobs is more than what energy advocates claim the entire clean energy industry employs in Minnesota. So advocates for clean energy policy say that there are 14,000 clean energy jobs in the whole state, which, you know, it sounds impressive. You know, there are many towns that you've all heard of in Minnesota that don't have that many residents. But if you look at it in terms of state employment, it's well under 0.5%. So in the grand scheme of things, it doesn't turn out to be become a big driver of employment prospects in the state of Minnesota. And our concern is we pay for it in terms of higher cost per kilowatt hour on our electric bills. And that is on net costing the state jobs. So we are not creating green jobs galore and driving employment up and unemployment down with our green energy policies. We believe that the data will show that this suite of policies has in fact cost the state jobs since it's been implemented starting really about 20 years ago. And again, if you look at the data, we really believe it's the low income households that bear the brunt on this. When you put aside energy intensive industry, the people who bear the brunt of these policies are not, for the most part, notwithstanding who your employer might be, but the people who write checks and live in nice houses and have nice incomes, whether it goes up a penny or two or three a kilowatt hour, it's not going to change your lifestyle. But what's interesting, these are national numbers. This isn't Minnesota only, but these are national numbers that this has been part of a long-term trend going, this goes back to 1984, but going back decades before that, when we used to talk about electricity being penny cheap or too cheap to meter, and then some of the heyday of the industry, as a percentage of household income, it has steadily fallen decade after decade after decade. As our household incomes grow, as we become a wealthier society, energy, like most commodities, has shrunk in terms of the command it has on our household budgets. And that was true until about the beginning of the last decade. And then we hit bottom, and although it's been up and down a little bit, it's shown a steady trend where the price you pay for electricity or for energy as a percent of your household budget has steadily climbed after having fallen for something like 40, 50, 60 years. When we break this down by the income of households, it illustrates in a perhaps a little bit better way the point I was making before about whose heart is hit. If this is dividing up America, this is all of America, not just Minnesota, but all of America by quintile, by 20% increments, 20% brackets in household income. So the blue lines represent the percentage we were paying for energy in our households 10 years ago, well, 2012, the most recent data we have. But a decade ago, those are the blue bars. And then the red bars are more recent data. So for every income group, we pay more of our budget, household budget, for energy. So it's not as if energy is a luxury good, that you make more money, you have a bigger house, you end up paying more as a share. No, it's gone up for every income quintile, but more for the low income household. It's a necessity. If you're low income, your high income, doesn't matter, you need electricity to live a modern life, and that's gonna take a bigger chunk of your income as a household if you're a poor household than if you're a wealthier household. So it's 11% now, more than 11%. If you're a low-income household, more than 11% of your income is going toward your electric or your energy bills. And that's up there, not far behind shelter and food is one of those necessities of life. And we were looking at some data for even lower, trying to break that bottom 20% down even further. And the lowest of the low income is something like 30% of your household budget is going to energy. And we have programs at the State Department of Commerce. We ran programs to help low-income households pay their energy bills. It doesn't cover everything. It doesn't even come close to covering everything. In fact, by some of the advocates in that area, Minnesota has one of the larger affordability gaps for energy. Despite all the money we put into low-income programs to help out on energy bills, we use a lot of energy up here. Now, if you look at the coastal California energy bills with that ocean current nearby, they don't have to heat in the winter, there's not much air conditioning in the summer. We have very cold winters, we have short but hot summers. We spend a lot of money on energy in Minnesota. And so when our energy prices go up, it has a big impact on all of us, but a disproportionate impact on lower income households. And then, all of this probably would be okay if the benefits we were getting from these policies outweighed those costs. And you will hear advocates for renewable energy and some of the clean energy policy who say that. They say the benefits are multiples of what the costs are. But you look at the data and you just can't find it. And in some areas, there's just no way to accurately measure what those benefits are. So some ways, it's completely speculative what, if any benefits we're getting from some of these policies. I would guess that if you did a poll, a public opinion poll, most Minnesotans would say they would be willing to pay a little bit more for their electricity to get environmental benefits, to get job creation, to get some of these other bennies that are touted by advocates. I think most people would say that that's a fair trade-off. I don't know, maybe most people in this room would feel that way, that we were willing to pay a little bit more for electricity if we could have a cleaner environment, if we could create jobs for the unemployed. And, but we're not finding that in the data. We're not finding that jobs are being created on that. We're not finding environmental improvement from these policies. And you know, at best, these benefits are being oversold, but at worst, they're completely non-existent, or in terms of jobs, are actually going in the other direction. And most of these policies today, you know, they might have been created for different reasons decades ago, but today they're justified because of their impact on climate change, on global warming, on carbon dioxide reductions. And you know, I don't really care how you come out on that issue, whether you're a believer or a denier, wherever you are on that scale, there just isn't the math to support Minnesota being a leader in these policies, because our profile, and then we'll do Peter's animation here. 32 days, if Minnesota were to stop carbon emissions cold turkey, we don't do it anymore. We were to, you know, either pack up all 5.5 million of us and move out of state. We were just to go back to the way we lived in the, you know, the pioneer days, and we didn't do carbon emissions. In 32 days, the growth in world carbon emissions would wipe out our entire output. So that's Minnesota, and it's something along the line of 5 years or 7 years for the country as a whole. If the United States just stopped emitting carbon, that whether it's China, India, the developing world, the increase that they are seeing in their emissions output would wipe out our total emissions output in a matter of a few years. So as much as you hear statistics like we have 5% of the population, but we use 25% of the world's energy, or whatever the statistic is, A, it's no longer true, and B, it's quickly becoming something that's overwhelmed by other factors going on. So we might have 5% of the world's population, we have 17% of the world's carbon emissions. We are no longer number one. China passed us some years ago and has left us far behind. China's emissions are going to be within a couple of years double what ours are, and they continue to grow as their economy grows, as India's economy grows. We might think we're doing a great deal by implementing these policies to help A, our local environment, or B, doing our part to contribute to reversing climate change in the rest of the globe, but as important as we think we are here in Minnesota, and as important we think we are to the rest of the world, the math just doesn't support that, that we are a small player in the global scheme of things, and as much as we have done, and we have done more than most states to reduce our carbon footprint, it's not going to show up on the worldwide statistics. And there's lots of advocates of these policies who point to climate change, whether look out the window here at the trees and the flora and fauna in our great state and the impact that climate change has had on wildlife or the growing season or invasive species or any of that. We could stop emitting carbon today, never emit another pound of carbon, and it would have no local impact. It's not like mercury or sulfur, where you emit it into the atmosphere and the impacts occur in the immediate vicinity. This issue of climate change and global warming is literally that. It's a global issue. So it's not how many pounds of carbon get emitted at this location on the map. It's anywhere. It doesn't matter whether it's at the South Pole, it's at the equator, it's how much is in the atmosphere and with the jet stream and the mixing the atmospheres is all over the globe. So we are sold on the idea we'll adopt these policies and it'll stop invasive species in the Minnesota, or it'll stop wildlife loss here in Minnesota. You know, as much as I would like to believe that to be true, what doesn't really matter what we do locally, it doesn't have a local impact. All right, and then the consequences of not acting, run through those, just the opposite, as you would guess, of the consequences of having acted over the years. that will have even higher prices. And you saw how steep that curve was the last couple of years. Fewer jobs, as our energy prices go up, yes, we might create a few jobs in the solar power sector or some other industry, but we do it at the risk, and I would say the certainty, of losing jobs in other sectors. And our budget, you know, this is interesting. It's not just your household budget, but it's budgets for school boards, it's budgets for local governments, it's budgets for everything else, universities, you know, it's everybody pays energy prices, everybody pays an electric bill, and it ripples through our entire economy. What needs to be done, and you know, I think, again, this is my management consultant background speaking, this is my management graduate education speaking. You can't manage what you don't measure. And we do not, we measure every kilowatt hour of wind power we produce. We measure every solar panel that gets installed in Minnesota. We don't take any kind of official notice of where we rank on the league tables and energy affordability. We really pay very little attention to the energy affordability issue for our low-income households. We do not track our competitiveness on energy prices the way Kentucky, for example, does. And I think the way to get around that is setting a specific goal and assigning, meeting that goal to a specific public body. And in Minnesota, not true for cooperative utilities or for the most part, or for city-owned utilities, but our state's investor-owned utilities who cover most of the state, their prices are set by a body called the Public Utilities Commission. And I think we should set a goal of having our energy electricity prices reduced in real terms by 10%. And 10% is not just an arbitrary big round number to shoot for, but in looking at the data, that's what it would take to get us competitive again, to flip the switch from being uncompetitive, unaffordable in energy prices, to being competitive with our other states and being affordable again. So we need to knock down our overall energy, electricity prices by about 10% to get from the top half to the bottom half of the table again, the way we were 20, 30 years ago. And we need to direct the PUC to meet that goal, because if you don't assign it to somebody and hold that somebody accountable, like everything else in government, it will never get done. And we would specifically want to look at a couple of policies that have been passed, and if we can't eliminate those policies, at least suspend the further implementation of those policies until we see prices fall relative to the rest of the country. And if we could, I don't know if I get into the details on the slides here, but it's the renewable energy mandate, the solar power mandate, and the energy efficiency mandate. Those we think have had the biggest impact on the prices we pay for electricity in Minnesota, the biggest negative impact. And I'll give the example of the renewable energy standard as something to illustrate the larger issue. When that was passed back in the last decade, my former boss signed it into law, and we're now joined by State Representative Pat Garofalo, who was in the legislature when that happened, who was our lead Republican energy person in the state legislature. But it was passed, and we wrote into the law what we thought was an off-ramp, that if prices got to be too high, and as some of our cooperative utilities reported, that it was costing tens of millions of dollars to meet the mandate, we could either hit the pause button or do a little rethink, and we thought we had written in the flexibility of the Public Utilities Commission to do that. If prices got out of hand, you know, we passed the mandate, you'll have 25% of your energy or 30% of your energy come from renewable sources by the date certain in the future. We didn't say as long as it wasn't doubling your rates or as long as it wasn't 100% more than your other power sources. We didn't put any kind of a cap into it. We said you will meet the mandate, you will do the best you can. We didn't give you an out. We thought we did. We thought we had a little off-ramp for if prices caused the state to be uncompetitive or prices to be unaffordable, the Public Utilities Commission had the power to step in and say, hold in a minute. But as it turns out, when we actually brought the issue to the commission, they said, well, we don't quite understand the direction we got. We don't think we can implement it, so we don't think we can do anything. And we've struggled in the years since to write some new language to give the commission the power to hit the pause button. And we think we really need to give them that authority. and clearly direct them to use it, because we don't have that situation today. And like with a lot of things, with location, location, location is the driving factor in renewable energy. The best locations for wind power, or went back 20 years ago when we did our first wind farms, and as we ramped up the production, you know, we've the second best locations have been taken, and we're working on the third best location. So that cost per kilowatt hour to implement is going to keep going up, even though equipment costs are falling, and have fallen quite dramatically. The cost of procuring locations, the cost of building transmission lines, are a huge factor in the overall cost that you pay per kilowatt hour, and those will just keep going down. And again, you know, we need to stop the bleeding in some ways. We need to say, hey, enough is enough. It's great to be a state leader, great to be a worldwide leader in renewable energy production, but at what cost? And if you look at Europe, a lot of the countries we point to as this is the policy we should follow, whether Germany or Spain, they're going through big rethinks of this, that they have some of the highest electricity prices in Europe and in the world, and their industry, their households can't afford it. So they're in the process in Germany and Spain and elsewhere in Europe of rethinking a lot of the same policies that we're touting as world leading. Oh, all right, so this is another recommendation that we're quite serious about. So when we've had these efforts to figure out, well, what's the cost of all this? How much extra are we paying for renewable energy than we were paying for conventional energy? The answer is everybody has an opinion and nobody agrees on anything. So we have cooperatives saying it's costing us tens of millions of dollars to meet this mandate. We have advocates for renewable energy who are saying it's saving you money. You're paying less as a result of this. And so we need a referee to come in and say, this is the real deal. This is the number. Don't take this advocate's, don't take this opponent's word for it. And we thought we could maybe bring in one of the big four nationally recognized accounting firms, somebody who doesn't have a dog in the fight, somebody who isn't an advocate for a set of policies or an advocate for a different set of policies, to come in and do the math and, you know, let the accountants tell us what the deal is, and we'll move forward from that. So we track, as I mentioned, all the green energy we produce. We track every kilowatt hour that we think we're saving through our energy efficiency efforts. We're not calculating the cost. We're not calculating the impact on the bill. And we think this might be a way of getting a neutral fact finder in here and doing the work and at least having good data to work on. And then I mentioned you can't manage what you don't measure. You can't make good policy unless you're working from a good set of facts. And a common set of facts on which everybody agrees, which we have in some of these other policy areas, like education. There's not a dispute over the size of the achievement gap or what demographic groups are impacted most by the achievement gap. In pension funds, we might have a disagreement about just how much our pensions are underfunded. The fact that our pensions are underfunded, everyone agrees on, and everybody agrees on the order of magnitude that they're underfunded. Maybe we don't all agree on what the solution is, but if we could, in the energy sector, agree on a common set of parameters, a common set of measures of what this is costing us in terms of dollars and jobs, and maybe we could craft better policies that everybody could get behind. And then again, you know, measuring and managing, we need to have an annual report. We have any report. Being in state government, I came up with a list just of my little part of the Department of Energy. It was something like three dozen reports that the state legislature mandated we crank out. They weren't all every year. Some of them were every 2 years, 3 years, 4 years. They were all like cicadas. They were all in a different cycle. We produced them just as the legislature suggested. We need, we think, an annual report to give the Public Utilities Commission, to give state legislators, to give the executive branch a common set of facts to work on when they're drafting legislation. Which brings me, I think, is to my next slide. This has been my hobby horse ever since I worked for the governor. You know, we have laws on the books that the state legislature, when they're passing a new mandate in state government, they have to do a cost impact analysis, where we have the nonpartisan researchers, just like the Congressional Budget Office or the General Accountability Office at the federal level, those pencil out what this, whether it's a new health plan or you know, a new forestry service in Department of Ag or something like that, what it'll cost the budget. We measure the impact on future budgets not just for the next 2 years, but the 2 years after that, we do it down to the penny. And so when somebody's decided whether to push the red button or the green button when they're voting on a bill, they've got in front of them a good estimate of what that's going to cost taxpayers. We have nothing of the sort in energy policy. And I thought we need a Truth in Rate Paying Act, where if we had a measure.
A fiscal note?
A fiscal note, exactly. That's what we call the, I was trying, thanks, trying not to get too into the jargon, but we have a fiscal note for every bill we pass that impacts the budget. We need a fiscal note for every bill that impacts your electric bill or your gas bill. So legislators at least are going in with their eyes wide open, and we didn't have that when we passed any of these other mandates. We just said, hey, utilities, they're experts at managing this, they'll do the best work, and you know, prices are coming down, it'll all work out in the end. Well, it didn't all work out in the end. And we really did not give our policymakers any inkling on what this would cost going in the future. And we tried to turn the tides on that a little bit when I worked for the governor. This solar power mandate that got voted in last year was not a new idea. It was something that was proposed, I don't know how far back it's been proposed, but it's been around for a long time. And my staff, on an earlier version of it, I think when it was a 10% mandate, did a little back of the envelope calculation and calculated it would be $1 billion a year rate impact. I think that opened a lot of eyes on the Capitol Hill. What should we vote for another $1 billion rate increase for our consumers? In the end, they scaled it back and quite a bit, but it's still going to have an impact on your electric bill. But it's that sort of thing. Okay, if I pass this bill, if I vote green, what's it going to do to consumer bills in the next year, 10 years, 5 years down the road? And let's have that information. And maybe our legislators will be willing to make that trade-off. Okay, for $1 billion, and we're going to, you know, and whatever the benefits are, we can do that calculus and decide whether it makes sense or not. But at least have the data available. All right, well, that's our blueprint. It's our energy blueprint. We focused almost exclusively on electricity because we think that's really where the next legislature, the governor, whoever that governor is in 2015, should focus on getting our policy back to right. And again, with the 10% rate reduction and a lot of these other things that we put forward in more detail in our written paper, we didn't get here overnight. We're not going to get it fixed overnight. So whether it's going to take the next legislature, the next governor's term, two terms. It took, this problem has been 20 years in the making. We're not going to fix it overnight, but we really think we have to start reversing this trend, because you saw the graph, how steep that increase is relative to the rest of the country, relative to inflation. That's unsustainable. So we need to start making some changes and start making them now. With that, I'll take your questions.
I was going to say, before we do get your questions this morning, if you liked what you heard, if you found this to be a quality product and a compelling case for revisiting our energy policies, please share this with your network. The paper is on our website. You can take hard copies this morning. We will make the PowerPoint available sometime soon. Take it. It's a gift. And spread it around so that we get these ideas out and we get the momentum going for them. Help us create that momentum, if you will, here in Minnesota. And Bill, that was tremendous. I just learned a lot this morning. And your questions, we don't have a mic or anything. But I think it's a small enough room where we can hear, but we've got about, you know, 10, 15 minutes to work with.
Yes, ma'am.
clarify for me, when you were talking about one of the arguments for the green policy is the offset of the savings that we get and this and that and something else. While you didn't mention it, often I hear that one of the benefits is reduction in asthma and health costs, and that I assume that that's factored in.
Again, it's that's a second, third order effect. We have policies directly aimed at that. Asthma, often the culprit is what we call particulate matter. It's the little bits of dust and ash that are in the air from burning coal. We have efforts to reduce that, and it's the haze in the boundary waters. It's how do we produce these environmental impacts? And the solution to that's a technical solution at the power plant to pull that those little particles out of the waste stream toward those in the atmosphere. We're doing that, and utilities, and I'm sure we could have some of the folks in the room talking about the billions of dollars we've spent on upgrading our power plants to do just that. That's not only in the most indirect way impacted by these energy efficiency and renewable energy mandates. So you say, okay, the idea is we'll make wind power, and that will burn less coal, and that will produce health benefits, or we'll make solar power, or the energy efficiency stuff. We'll be more efficient in how we use energy, we'll use less of it. That means we'll burn less coal. The way the utilities operate their systems, the coal plants, they run 24 hours a day, 7 days a week at full output. When we use solar power and we use wind power on the system, that's much, much more likely to impact how much natural gas we burn than running natural gas power plants, just the way the system works. And those power plants don't contribute to the particulate matter problem in the atmosphere. So when people say we're not going to burn coal because we're making wind power, it's not quite the way we operate our utility grid in North America. The coal power is going to be used for the most part no matter what, because it's our baseload resource. Now, in spring and fall, that might not be true because we might take plants offline for maintenance, keep them offline longer. You know, but at the margins, it's natural gas that's the fuel that we're either burning more of or less of. And so when somebody says we're going to do 30% wind power and it's going to have all these health benefits because we're not going to burn coal, I would suggest you go to the Mid-Continent System Operator, as in the operation in St. Paul, and you can see the big screen, and they can tell you exactly what plants are online at any instant in time, and learn a little bit about how the system works. So I hear these benefits touted, but they don't quite correspond to utility practices. Yes, sir.
One of the ideas that you didn't mention that I wondered about is could we move to a fully accelerated depreciation of any investment that corporations make, so that they make the depreciation actually lowers their taxes in Minnesota right away, and then we take some of that fund from the subsidies that are going someplace else to address the tax revenue impact of fully depreciated investment on anything that's going to reduce your energy. It's a tricky thing too. It's not simple, but to be focused in that sort of way. You didn't mention anything along those lines.
Well, I didn't, because I have to say I'm not a tax expert. I don't even do my own. I farm that out. So. But I did notice that Pat's making a note there, and you're sitting right next to Scott, so I think you got the right audience for your comment. But no, there are things that we do with the tax code to provide incentives for all kinds of renewable energy. But I think you bring up, are we providing incentives for the right thing? Maybe we need to directly provide incentives for energy efficiency and to the right people. Well, is providing incentives to the utility the right way to get more energy efficiency versus providing incentives to the user of energy? So I think that's a fair point.
Sorry, the other ones that you tried to paint, and I think you started to paint it, was the connection between economic growth and energy costs.
Mm-hmm.
I think that is something that, if you could visualize that, you go through all the 80s, and you look at the GDP growth and how that changed with the drop in energy costs in 1984, and probably going back further when we had energy costs in the 70s that went crazy, and track what that does with GDP and help people really cement that connection between energy costs and the economic growth, I think that would be helpful for this presentation.
No, I think that's a good point. Actually, so Pierre and I were working on, we eventually ran out of time, but something we were working on, making exactly that linkage. And if you look at reports, the International Energy Agency is another good source of information. And if you look at the developing world, what we used to call the third world, but the developing world, energy use per capita increasing is a proxy they use for how quickly they're developing as a nation. We have just the opposite viewpoint, that we're developing as a society if we use less energy. But for most of the developing world, it's a sign where they don't have good economic statistics, but they have fairly good statistics on how much electric companies are selling and billing to customers. It's a proxy for economic growth. And you are correct. everywhere else in history, and anywhere, anytime else in time, that we have a direct link between energy usage, electricity availability, electricity affordability, and economic development. Those are one-to-one matches in terms of linkage. I know this guy's had his hand for a while.
We've got tremendous subsidies for wind and solar, but it doesn't seem to be reflected on the electric bill to say, this is what your tax dollars subsidizing. You know, it says you pay 11 cents or whatever, but if you factored in the subsidies, what would that number be?
Peter, do you have a number off the top of your head?
Well, that's why we have the recommendation to actually have a lobbying firm study this. I mean, there's so many different green energy policies out there. There's just the renewable energy.
You know, I've tried to do some back of the envelope calculations. I think it's a cent right there that we're paying per kilowatt, but I don't have, because I don't have access to everybody's purchase power agreement, can't really come up with a good number. But that's one of our recommendations. And we have utilities. And I just happened to do a project for a client where I was comparing electric bills from different kinds of utilities around the state. And some of them do. Some of them have a line item for renewable energy costs. They broke it out on the bill, what they're paying. And but you mentioned the subsidies. Most of the subsidies in terms of dollars for renewable energy comes from the federal government in terms of the production tax credit or some of the capital credits they give to developers. So again, you pay federal taxes, I pay federal taxes. We're paying it every time we have money withheld or you write that check to the IRS. That doesn't show up on your electric bill. So electric consumers, and it's reflected in none of the data I show here, reflect the subsidies that the federal government, or we used to in the state government, we don't anymore, would give taxpayer dollars to energy producers.
I'd like to see that.
No, I think that's a great recommendation.
Tagging on to that, one of the northern co-ops does break out the cost of the mandates and show it on the bill. And I would think that that'd be a good eighth recommendation that utilities across the state do that.
I think so. And again, one of the things we did in putting this document together was always keep in mind it's something of a living document, an organic document that we're going to continue to work on for the next couple of months. So yeah, these recommendations, if we don't get to them today, if you could email me or somebody at the center.
And a question on your slides for figures 2 and 3, the commercial and the industrial, there's a dip that occurred from about 2000 to 2004, a significant dip. Do we know what the circumstances were that caused that, and should we be replicating that?
How can we get back to there? As I stand here, I have nothing popping to mind. Some of it is you take the hit and you have some years of stability and policy, and utilities can adapt and they can manage to whatever situation. Then you have another mandate passed and that phases in. Again, so one of the recommendations we said was let the PUC hit the pause button. You know, let's have 4 or 5 years where nothing changes. Let utilities adapt to what we've already told them to do. That would be a big improvement. Part of the issue is, and we have some utility people in the room here, is I don't remember the last year, maybe it was 2004, where we didn't have a big new energy mandate. It has, except for the 2 years when we had state Republicans in charge, we didn't have a new energy mandate. But we did almost every year through the mid-2000s, and we had the last 2 years, new mandates. And it's just that we introduced into what's been a fairly static industry a huge amount of dynamism, and that doesn't help. I'll get back to you. I'll give somebody else another chance. First chance. Yes, sir.
Does the reverse math work? We drop a penny, you add 15,000 jobs?
I don't think the state of Kentucky looked at that, but you would like to think that the math worked.
Would that be the first question you'd ask?
We could get
subsidize
some
industrial electricity, and you take, let's say, a half cent or whatever, you add 7,000 jobs. And probably cheaper than any program.
And people have done that. I mentioned Germany. To the extent, and they have very competitive heavy industry, has been competitive because that 30 cent a kilowatt hour that Germans pay, they don't make industry pay that. They exempt their big industry from all of these renewable energy mandates. That was one of those interesting developments in the solar power mandate, was how effective lobbyists were for big industry in getting their constituents exempted from that. We kept hearing what a great deal it was for everybody, but the people who pay those million-dollar a year electricity bills had a little different opinion and got themselves exempt. So that was a little step in the right direction. New York State has been very aggressive about doing that. They do all kinds of bad things on one side, and they try to make up for it on the other side of the ledger by they have something called the New York Power Authority, which provides low-cost energy to heavy industry. I'm not sure that's the solution. The two wrongs make a right. But I would think it's the mathematical properties are probably such that you reverse it and you start getting jobs back. I'll go to Christina and then I'll go to Pat.
No, I'll let the representative go first.
I was, thanks, Bill. Can you explain at a high level what net metering is and how that is a sort of a secret incentive slash subsidy that's in law right now?
Right. Well, the idea is you as an energy consumer, you pay, in my case, it's 12 cents a kilowatt hour, but, 10, 11, 12 cents a kilowatt hour for your electricity at your home. If you were to go put a couple of solar panels on your house, there would be times that maybe you're not using, you want a vacation for a month, and if you had the right piece of gear, if you had an inverter, that the power could flow back onto the grid. That you, as Pat Garofalo energy consumer, could become Pat Garofalo energy producer. If you had enough solar panels on your roof or on your property, you could actually put power onto the grid, or at certain times put power onto the grid. And that was a way that some people thought, well, this would be a great way of providing incentive to small customers, residential customers, small commercial customers to do energy, renewable energy, solar power. Really, it's about the old, you could put a wind turbine in your yard, but there are people who tried that and their neighbors didn't think much of the idea. It's caused some issues in some communities around the state. But solar panels, there's not too much disagreement with. So if you became an energy producer and ended up putting power back on the grid, that was the price you would pay. You would get paid the same price you were paying for power. The problem you quickly run into in that is, I pay 12 cents a kilowatt hour for power at my home. Accept your sympathy afterward. 12 cents a kilowatt hour, but that is the all-in price. That's the cost to generate electricity with coal or wind or wherever we're generating it at, the transmission cost, the local delivery cost, the cost to pay for all the overhead the utility incurs, the accountants to figure out how much my bill is, and the technicians who put the lines back up on the poles after the storm's knocking down, and all that's rolled into what you pay on your electric bill. So what you're putting on the grid, your solar power, really is worth only 2 to 5 cents of that 12 cents, depending on whatever. So you put power into the grid and net metering gives you 12 cents a kilowatt hour for it, but what you've given in return may only be worth 2 cents a kilowatt hour. So that's the subsidy. You're getting subsidized something like a nickel or a dime. That's probably not too much of a problem as long as we limit the size of these projects to something that a household would put on their roof or a small business would put on their roof. We have projects, if you look at the solar panels that are on top of the convention center, downtown Minneapolis, or there's some projects on some of the big roofs downtown in St. Paul, they end up being megawatt size, enough to power 1,000 customers. And so when you have projects that are that big and you're paying 12 cents a kilowatt hour, well, it quickly results in an uneconomic situation for utilities. Again, don't want to go too deep into my history on this stuff, but one of my clients was a utility that serves 800 customers. And I did the math on this net metering, and if you move the net metering up to a megawatt, and somebody decided to hook a megawatt onto the system of this little community in central Minnesota, the first thing they would do with that application is take it to the federal district court and file bankruptcy, because that nickel subsidy on a customer that size would wipe it out. And Excel is so big, you wouldn't notice it on your bill, but those are one of the issues we struggle with. We want to provide subsidies, we want to do it in small scale ways that help homeowners, but the math matters. And eventually the math catches up to you and either you're a bankruptcy court or you're uncompetitive in the world table on electricity prices. But net metering is a way of subsidizing small customers to produce electricity by having you pay the price you pay the utility that's your provider.
It's just about 9 o'clock.
Okay, I'll get Christina in and then we'll thanks for coming. Yes, Christina.
Well, thank you so much for your presentation and for the Center of the American Experiment to just take the time to be able to focus on these issues. Too few people or groups in Minnesota really take a serious look at this. So thank you to all your contributors that make this possible. But just thinking about your blueprint and what have you laid out, and you really focused on Minnesota policy and where we've come to date and what it has caused, but they're now operating in a grander scheme of things also because our policies have also pushed some things at the federal level. Now the federal level is trying to put this on all states. And as it is, we're going to be facing this EPA ruling or rules on coal power plants. If you think our prices have increased in Minnesota at this point just because of state policy, just wait if this stuff passes at the federal level. So you need to speak up now and get your networks to speak up now and call the congressional reps to say no. Because they're going to go up even higher. So if we try here through the center and your work and at the legislature to lower our rates 10%, that is going to be so difficult to do if the stuff passes at the federal level. It's going to be difficult to roll back. I just find it funny, not really funny, it's sad that we pass all these things in Minnesota. And one of the reasons that Ellen Anderson said we had to pass this was we need to get out ahead and be a leader. Well, now at the federal level, we're getting zero credit for the work we've done since 2005 on this renewable and energy efficiency stuff. And the last thing I'll close on is this energy efficiency stuff. There is a lot more time being spent at utilities on the administrative end of this that's not getting reported as spending because they're already being urged by the Department of Commerce that they're spending too much money achieving saving or to spending too much money to try to achieve savings. The state law says you have to do a 1.5% spending and you have to do 1.5% savings. And it's coming in about some utilities are spending about 30% more spending just to get that 1.5% savings. So instead of trying to look at the law and rethink it, they're making utilities report even more administrative work, exactly how they're doing their business, exactly how they're encouraging their customers to do energy efficiency, when in a perfect world we'd all be doing it voluntarily because it just makes sense.
A good observation. And then just I'll share in my brief tenure as a utility company executive, one of the toughest things I ever had to do was spend money on saving energy. So thanks for the chamber for having us here. And I know if this was the Rotary, they would already rung the bell on me. So
I tried to ring the bell. Thanks for being here this morning.
Oh, nice.